After her acclaimed biography, Sartre, A Life, 1987, became an international bestseller, translated into 16 languages, cultural historian Annie Cohen Solal was asked by the French president, François Mitterrand, to serve as the cultural counselor to the French embassy in the United States. Within 2 weeks of her arrival in 1989, she met Leo Castelli, America's most influential art gallerist of the period, who told her, "I'm going to teach you all you need to know about American art." Her encounter with Castelli led her first work to her first work of art history, Painting American, 2001, an account of the shift of the artistic center from Paris to New York throughout the late 19th and early 20th centuries. It was awarded the Prix Bernier of the Académie des Beaux-Arts. Her next book, Leo Castelli and His Circle, 2010, was acclaimed by critics as probing, gripping, impeccably judicious, marvelous, impressive, elegant, and was awarded the Art Curial Prize for the best contemporary art book and translated into 5 languages. In 2014, she authored with Paul Goldberger and Robert Gottlieb, New York Mid-Century, which was described as, quote, the work of 3 masters of their genres, and was hailed as a sparkling account of Gotham and a sophisticated and elegant exploration. As a professor, she has held positions at Tisch School of the Arts at NYU, École des Hautes Études en Sciences Sociales, the École Normale Supérieure in Paris, the Freie University of Berlin, and the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. In 2013-14, she became special advisor at the École Normale Supérieure and at the Centre Pompidou, where she worked as chief curator, Magicians of the Earth, 2014. She is now co-leader of a forthcoming workshop at the Center for Advanced Studies in Behavioral Science at Stanford University on the theme Crossing Boundaries. Annie is working on an important exhibition about Rothko and Rembrandt that will debut at the Rijksmuseum in Amsterdam in 2017. Born in Algeria, a Mizrahi Jewish scholar, Cohen Solal received a PhD in history and literature from the Sorbonne and currently lives in Paris. Please welcome Annie Cohen Solal.
Thank you, Laurie. Thank you, Stephanie. I'm going to try to be at the level of these beautiful words. I am indeed delighted to be in San Francisco because, first of all, it's a city which has the same trees as my home country. And the first, as soon as I arrive, I feel home. And I'll be there a lot because of this new position at Stanford. I'm back already in a month, so you'll see a lot of me if you need me. Now, I also want to tell you that in this book tour, the lecture today might be one of the climax of my book tour. I'm talking in a few cities, like more than 10. But San Francisco is a place which had a very specific meaning for Mark Rothko. He wrote a beautiful text one day. He said, "What was there last summer, which seems now to have been so magical in San Francisco?" So there was a magic attached to the city for him. It's a city where he taught and thrived. It's a city where he was happy. It's a city where he experienced things which were not as painful as New York City. And it's also a city where there will be, you'll see later on, a private guest, a surprise guest, which is which is marvelous. So please wait a little bit. But you'll see this guest. It's extraordinary what happened here 2 days ago. So you'll see. So instead of talking 45 minutes, I'll speak a little less, and then I'll leave space for our guest, a discussion with him. So the first thing I want to tell you about my work, about Mark Rothko in general, is that I am not an art historian, classical art historian. First of all, by training, I am a historian, a social historian and a cultural historian. So I am not going to spend much time describing works of art to you, but I'm going more to describe the artist in the context of his time. This is Mark Rothko with the different names he had. He was born Markus Rotkovich. When he came to the US at age 10, they changed his name to Markus Rotkovich with a K and a W and a Z, which he didn't like very much. He thought it was very heavy. And when he changed his name and Americanized it and became an American citizen, he called himself Mark Rothko. Different from his brothers, who called themselves Roth. And that's kind of interesting. This is what he wrote about the city. The city is unspeakably beautiful and the weather perfect. There is no doubt that by its visual attributes alone, the city has earned the right to be the art center of the world, and that we must do something to bring this about. That he wrote from San Francisco in the fall of 1947. So it's a first of all a tribute to the city by him. Okay, so my approach is tonight I'm going to describe Mark Rothko's trajectory through different angles. The first would be the aesthetic way, the aesthetic trajectory. One could talk about him just by saying that first he was painting figurative, 1936, a self-portrait, 1938, entrance to the subway. And then he went through a very quick change of aesthetics between mythological, then surrealist, then multiform, and then abstract. Okay, so between 1940 and 1950, he gets to abstraction. And here we have these floating rectangles of color floating on top of the other one. This is his signature style that we see blue in red and yellow, in red and brown, in yellow, and here at the last years of his life, gray, brown and gray and black. Now, one thing I want to say about the colors. At the Tate Gallery, where there is a Rothko room, a text on the wall says, at the end of his life, Rothko went into a darkening of the palette. So he seems to be explained, all his trajectory seems to be explained by a question of colors. It is something that I will argue against, because I think that Rothko's life is much more complicated than a simple question of color and palette. I will argue that his life is that of a painter, but also of an intellectual, of an immigrant, of an artist, of a pioneer. So this is the second angle that I'm going to adopt, the historical angle. First of all, the immigrant. He gets to the US at the age of 10 in 1913. He arrives in Portland, Oregon, by way of a trip throughout the United States, joining his family, the Weinsteins. And as soon as he arrives in Portland, Oregon, he is a very well-read young scholar, because he had studied in the Talmud Torah in Vinsk, where he was born. But he notices that in the city, and especially in the high school where he is, the clubs, the debating clubs, are not very welcoming for Jews. So he goes to this neighborhood house, which is a community center organized by the German Jews for the new immigrants, the Russian Jews. And there he becomes a leader. He becomes the chief editor and he writes the editorial for the 10th anniversary. Markus Rotkowicz, A Year's Perspective. He is the one who writes that. So when he faces hostility, when he faces rejection, his attitude is to stand up as a leader and to fight with his pencil and with his words as a writer. Very soon, with his friends Max Neimark and Harry Director, he is brilliant enough to arrive, to manage to get into Yale. Here is what the magazine, the daily paper says. Three Russian boys, none of whom has been in this country longer than 7 years, they are just gone to enter Yale. Well, this is a great achievement for a young scholar, but unfortunately, Yale University in 1921 is a place where Jews are not welcome, and where here, this is him, I don't look like this, he wrote. He doesn't like the way he looks, he looks very stiff, very, very stern. This year, the dean is going to write to the president, the Jews are coming to us by thousands. They win all the scholarships. I think that we have to change our view in regard to the Jewish element. We should do something to improve them. They are getting there rapidly. If we do not educate them, they will overrun us. A few years ago, every single scholarship of any value was won by a Jew. We must put a ban on the Jews. Frederick S. Jones, Dean of Yale College, 1921. So no wonder that the young Markus Rotkowicz, who thinks he's getting into the epitome of, the elite universities, finds himself with, students who are more interested in sports and, fraternities than in scholar matters. So what he does, he creates his own magazine, the Yale Saturday Evening Pest, that is going to disappear when he disappears after a year and a half. And this is what he attacks. He attacks the false gods of these students, which are, clubs of sports clubs and fraternities. False gods, idols of clay. There is only one way to smash them, and that is a revolution in mind and spirit in the student body at Yale University. Let us doubt, let us think, that is enough. So we see a young scholar who is not ready to comply with the institutions who are rejecting him, who is standing up, who is a rebel, who is a writer, who is an intellectual. And after a year and a half, he leaves Yale and, goes and work with his family here and there, travels back and forth to Portland until he finds a revelation in becoming an artist. Becoming an artist for him will be both an epiphany and a necessity. The first group he joins is the group of the 10. They are actually 9. But they are experimenters by the very nature of their approach and strongly individualistic. Here they are. Ilya Bolotovsky, Adolf Gottlieb, Louis Harris, Yankel Kufeld, Markus Rotkowicz, Louis Schenker, Nahum Chabakov, Joseph Solman, Ben-Sion Weinman, all immigrants, first or second generation. So they are linked by a common bond, which is that of migration. They are not linked by their works, which, as you see, are completely different. Some are abstract, some are cubist, some are expressionist. So those young artists are not linked by any aesthetic reasons, except that they fight the galleries in New York City. So it's a social bond. The next step in his career is that Markus Rotkowicz becomes an educator, a teacher, at the Brooklyn Jewish Center School Academy, according to John Dewey theories, and for 25 years he's going to be a teacher there. Teaching art will give him both stability, financially and professionally. And we'll see what it means for him to be an educator later on. What else he does, he's writing a book in 1940, at the time where the Nazi armies are invading Europe. He puts his brush aside and takes a pencil, and for one whole year, he stops painting and he writes. He writes this book, The Artist's Reality, Philosophies of Art. In this book, he revisits art history from antiquity. He asks himself when were the golden ages for the artist, what is art, what is the function of an artist in society. And that whole book where he revisits, you know, the great thinkers of Europe, the great old masters of Europe, will help him change his aesthetic patterns, switch to mythological, and then surrealist, and then abstract. Now, two sentences from this book which I want to quote for you. Art is not only a form of action, it is a form of social action. And the history of art is the history of men who, for the most part, have preferred hunger to compliance. So we see that in his mind, there is a kind of romantic image of the painter as a hero who goes his way, even if his way is not the way society is going. So it's a very strong decision, and one of the artists of the past that Rothko is going to completely identify with is Rembrandt, especially the late Rembrandt, that has decided to paint his own way and not to comply with the taste of the time. Then another specific attitude of Mark Rothko is that he will always, throughout his career, be on a search, shuttling, searching, changing. In this case, between the West Coast and the East Coast, as I told you, he spent the first part of his life in the United States, in Portland, Oregon, but he finds San Francisco much more appealing, in fact, than Portland. So shuttling between West Coast and East Coast, between US models and European models. The big influence of his life as a painter is Clifford Steele, who invites him to come to San Francisco, where he will spend many summers teaching, painting, living, and where his art will definitely take a shift towards this more expressive abstraction. And a very important moment also before 1950, where he gets into abstraction, is that at the Museum of Modern Art, he sees this painting by Henri Matisse, The Red Studio, painted in 1911, which Alfred Barr has bought for the permanent collection. So Mark Rothko sees the paintings, which is exhibited in the galleries, and for 3 weeks he's going to sit in front of it, absorbing himself inside the painting, inside the red, the flat red. It is, as you see, a studio of an artist with paintings and sculptures which are unfinished. And in the center, there's a void. In this void, this is the place where the artist should stand and either finish the works or leave them like that. If he finishes them, they become immortal works of art. If he does not, they go to garbage. So this painting, for me, is a metaphor of the power of creation. And I think that it is not an accident that it helped Rothko to get to his definitive signature style. Very quickly, Mark Rothko is going to go on fighting American institutions when they do not, when he do not accept their attitude. For example, the Met, the Metropolitan Museum. He is very conscious that the Metropolitan Museum of Art has a collection of American art which is not what it should be, because at the time they rejected, you know, the collection of Gertrude Vanderbilt Whitney. They rejected, they preferred European art. So with a group of friends, the Irascibles, they are very angry. Here we have Mark Rothko, Barnett Newman, Jackson Pollock, and Bill de Kooning. They write a letter to the New York Times, public letter, a letter which is going to be published in the New York Times to the director of the museum, where they say, we draw to the attention of these gentlemen the historical fact that for roughly 100 years, only advanced art has made any consequential contribution to civilization. That was to attack an exhibition where only regional artists were showed and not this group, not the more progressive artists. So anytime an institution is not behaving the way Rothko plans it, accepts it, he stands up and writes. Nevertheless, at the Modern, Dorothy Miller will show him in a group called 15 Americans, 1952. His gallerist will be Peggy Guggenheim, then Betty Parsons, then Sidney Janis. And in the 50s, he becomes a very successful artist, rich, successful, very well regarded by the critics. A very important show will take place at the Chicago Art Institute, put together by Catherine Koo in 1954. And it's after 1959 that we have the third part of his trajectory. He becomes a pioneer. Why would you ask then? Would you ask, why, if he is a successful artist, does he decide to shift gears? And that's exactly what he's going to do. In 1958, he's commissioned a piece for the Seagram Building, which he will not do, and that will start this period. During those years, he experimented ceaselessly, each painting a new adventure. He left little to chance, studying how the intensity, texture, and overall area of certain colors interacted. So instead of remaining the successful painter with his signature style, Mark Rothko is going to become a pioneer. How come? Because the Bronfman family is building on Park Avenue this huge skyscraper, the Seagram Building, commissioned by Philip Johnson. And for their restaurant, the Four Seasons restaurant, they want the best panels surrounding the public, and they ask Mark Rothko to deal with them. Mark Rothko will work on these panels for 1 year before spending his summer in Europe. This summer, he's going to shuttle in his head between Park Avenue and Europe, going to Naples, going to Florence, to see the Convento di San Marco, Fra Angelico, and noticing that this is exactly the way he wants his paintings to be. He wants the viewer to have the feeling that he interacts with his art. And so he starts doubting about what he's doing at in the Seagram Building. Then he goes to England, meets his British disciples. He meets William Scott. He meets them all in a little colony in Cornwall, where he sees a ruined chapel, medieval chapel, and feels that it is much more in this medieval chapel that he wants his art to be than on Park Avenue. Definitely he doesn't belong to that crowd. So he comes back, and that's when he gives back the money, he takes back the panels. And a few years later, Peter Selz decides to give him a solo show at MoMA in 1961, which is going to be an absolutely beautiful show where the panels for the Seagram building will be exhibited. And this might be the climax of his career. This is what Peter Selz wrote about. This is what Catherine Koo. As I look back, it was Mark's Museum of Modern Art exhibition in 1961 that radically changed his point of view. This is a landmark exhibition. And Peter Selz, in the catalog, described these silent paintings as dealing directly with human emotions, desires, relationships, for they are mirrors of our fantasies and serve as echoes of our experience. Now, after this show, Mark Rothko is working on his last project with this woman, his new patron, Dominique Dominil, who comes to him after hearing that he decided not to finish the Seagram building because he doesn't want to comply with that kind of crowd. He doesn't want to paint for people who would eat in front of his paintings. He wants people to weep in front of his paintings, not to eat in front of his paintings. So Dominique Dominil, who is also an immigrant who came from France in 1941, lived in Houston, and has always fought for the African Americans, for example, decides that she will build a chapel and Rothko would be doing the panels. They're working together until the Rothko Chapel in Houston is being inaugurated exactly a year after he commits suicide. And this is the inside of the chapel. I don't know if you have been there, but it's one of the most extraordinary places. And it is exactly what Rothko had dreamt to do. He wanted a space to be a space of meditation, a space with spiritual values rather than, consumption values. He wanted art to be an experience. He wanted the viewer to sit and interact with his paintings. He wanted his paintings to be law, to be on an off white wall. He wanted them to be very little lighted. And he really was very specific about the fact that people shouldn't pass by, but people should stay. People should be surrounded by art. So this is how he decided during the MoMA show of 1961 that he wanted to bring out a revolution in viewing. He wanted to revolutionize the way people would look at art and art be an experience. This is what Peter Selz wrote about these murals. These murals, like medieval altar pieces, really seem to ask for a special place apart, a kind of sanctuary, where they may perform what is essentially a sacramental function. So you see that the evolution in his work has taken a very interesting turn. And I will now go to another angle, that of the geographical trajectories, because Mark Rothko's life is one of displacement and migration. He was born in the Russian Empire in the city called Dvinsk, which is now part of Latvia. They traveled to the United States on a boat, such as the one that Stieglitz is showing here. They traveled by boat, by train, throughout the United States, and it took 3 weeks to go from New Haven to Portland. And he told his friend Motherwell, "You cannot imagine what it is," he said, "to be dressed like a little boy from Dvinsk in black suit, traveling all over the United States with the label around my neck, which said, "I don't speak English." So that was one of the trauma of his life. Then once he was living in New York, he traveled nonstop. He went back to the West Coast, San Francisco we see a lot. He went back to Portland, so East Coast, West Coast. Then he went back to Europe a lot, looking, searching, shuttling. His favorite country in Europe being Italy, and then England, and then the Netherlands. And then in New York also, he had many houses, many studios, always changing, always searching. Interesting also is to notice his family genealogy. His father, Jakob Rotkowicz, was a pharmacist in Vinsk, a very secular man, very well-read man. He was also the public writer of the city. He would write letters for people. He was a member of the Bund. And here is Markus Rotkowicz sitting with his little cousin standing, showing him off with a white ball. And I think that it's very interesting to see how the little boy of five, the little kid from the Talmud Torah, is already very serious, you know, very serious, like a real mensch. Think he didn't change his looks, you know. And we see him with the family here sitting to the right, and the cousin has a little dog, you know, the cousin is a worldly guy. And he, Markus Rotkowicz, has a book in his hands, you know. This is the family. And this is him with his wife, Mel, who was very beautiful and very interesting, very well-educated woman that gave him stability. His son, Christopher, who was six when his father committed suicide. But something happened with the son. And, you know, Mark Rothko changed gallery after Sidney Janis in 1962, because Sidney Janis had accepted to do a show of pop artists, and Rothko hated pop artists. So he left Sidney Janis for another gallery, the Marlborough Gallery, which was not very ethical with him. And there was a lawsuit when he committed suicide that was started by the children. Kate was 17. And Christopher was a little boy, a baby, but they won after a 14 years lawsuit. And the children have had a very important impact on their father's work, so much so that Christopher decided to, the book I showed you before, this manuscript, was found, the manuscript was found by Christopher recently. He transcribed the text he saw. He edited it and he published it 10 years ago at Yale University Press. And this book, The Artist's Reality, gives us the core of Mark Rothko's project. I think it's a very essential book. And I think it's extremely beautiful that a little boy who was six when his father passed away became the one who gave life to his father's voice so many decades later. But there's more to that. This is Kate and Christopher on the 23rd of April, 2013. They invited me to go to the opening of the Rothko Center in Daugavpils, the name of the city Dvinsk, where their father was born. Why? Because they had been asked to come back to the place where their father was born for his 100th anniversary. They first went. Their father had never gone back. I don't know if you know about the history of Latvia. Latvia is a country where the Jews were treated in the most despicable way. I don't know if there was a nice way to be, you know, persecuting the Jews and killing them, but this is maybe the worst one, by the Waffen-SS, and the Latvian people joined them. And the thriving Jewish culture was totally destroyed. The people were sent to the forest of Rumbula, killed, and immediately. It was horrible. So all Jewish culture has disappeared in Latvia. Nevertheless, Christopher and Kate went. The first thing they did was they supported the restoration of one synagogue on the 43 that were destroyed. And a few years later, here, they accepted to lend 8 works of art from their father to open a Mark Rothko center in the city where he was born, which was a huge building that I attended. I attended the opening. And when I went there, I saw in this gesture something very moving. I saw in this gesture a continuation of the father's decision, project, in his book, that the artist be a prophet, and that the work of art be something that in Hebrew we call it tikkun ha'olam, the reparation of the world. So the children of Mark Rothko, by lending works of art in this country, decided to perpetuate their father's project. So that's how I would like to end before telling you that one of my friends from Berkeley called Tom Ludi, who sits in the audience, came to Paris a month ago and told me, do you know that Peter Selz is my neighbor, my friend, and lives in Berkeley? So Peter Selz, I made a mistake. I did not check where he was when I did my research, and I felt terrible. I felt, well, Peter Selz did this most wonderful show at MoMA, and I didn't go and interview him. So I wrote to him a note last Sunday, like 2 days ago. I wrote a note to Peter Selz saying, I apologize, I have not interviewed you, but I would love you to be at the Jewish Cultural Center in San Francisco, if you may. And this is what he wrote me back. Dear Annie Cohen Solal, thank you very much for your kind note, which I just received. I will most certainly be at your lecture at the JCC. I think your Rothko book shows a deep understanding of his life and his great work. Mark would have liked to read all of it. Having read your Rothko book, I am now immersed in Leo, so much I did not know. Old as I am still learning. I also want to give you a book to you on Wednesday. If anything is planned after your lecture, I would be most pleased to attend. With best wishes, Peter Selz. Here is Peter Selz. Peter is coming. I was expecting him to the right. Hello, Peter. So, we're going to talk with Peter. Hello, Peter. Welcome.
Hello.
Welcome.
Hello.
Welcome. I think you're having the right seat. Here's Peter. You sit here. Here, wherever you want. I don't mind. This way. Peter was born in Munich in 1919 on the 27th of March. So in a week, in a 2 weeks, he's turning 97. I think this is historical. I was so moved. And he came alone. He came alone from Munich to the United States at the age of 17. His grandfather took him to galleries, to museums. He was born in the art world. After working in a brewery in New York City, he started studying at Columbia, but he was trained by a distant cousin called Alfred Stieglitz, which is not too bad. And then he did his PhD on German Expressionism in 1954 at the University of Chicago. He taught at Pomona College. He became a curator of paintings and sculpture at MoMA when he had his this Mark Rothko show. And then he became professor at Berkeley in in the height of the 60s, right?
Yeah, '65.
You were a leftist, a radical.
Yes.
Are you still? Are you still a radical?
Yes.
Okay. And two biographies have been written on Peter already, Karl Kastrom, and a memoir by his daughter Gabrielle Selz. So 5 years ago also, Peter got the College Art Association Award for the best book on art. And he also taught at CUNY. There's so much about him, so much. But what is extraordinary is that this coincidence that, you know, one of the great witnesses of Rothko's life is sitting with us today and can teach us so much more than what I have said. So I want you to talk, but I want just to add something. Oh. Once you said, I have always worked with artists who were not mainstream, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so Mark Rothko, when you ask him, when you want to do the Rothko show in 1961, you did not consider him mainstream then?
No, I think there's a book out of different things I wrote, an anthology published by Cambridge University Press called Beyond the Mainstream. And in general, my work has done very much on the for outsiders. Not Mark Rothko, but when I decided to do the Rothko show at that time,
yes,
he was already very much in the center of attention,
yes,
of New York artists. So I can't say I discovered him.
Okay. But when did you first meet him? I'd like to know that.
I met him around that time. I wanted to meet him because I was going to tell him we were going to do the show. The important, your book talks a good deal about Catherine Koo, who was the curator at the Art Institute of Chicago, where I did my graduate work. And her exhibition was when I really first became involved in Mark Rothko. I was astonished with this work, which I hardly knew before, just in reproduction. And I spent many days looking at these incredible paintings at the Art Institute. And basically, of course, years later, I became curator at the Museum of Modern Art. The first American show I did was of Mark Rothko.
So we are 1954, right?
Yeah.
So in this show in Chicago, Mark Rothko didn't come. He did not come.
No, he did not come.
He did not come. But he had already a very good relationship with her because
yes,
they were writing to each other.
Yes, yes.
And she even wanted to publish the correspondence.
Yes.
She did not do it in the end, but she wanted to do that. Okay, so that's 1954. Now,
yeah,
what happens between 1954 and 1961 in January, on the 18th of January, when you opened the Rothko show?
Well, during those years, I looked at my Rothko paintings whenever I could, and I admired them very, very much. I talked to them when I got to New York. Of course, I realized, you know, I talked to many people who knew his work, had many good conversations about his work with Dori Ashton.
Yes, with Dori Ashton, of course.
The only good book that's been written about Rothko before yours is hers.
Yes. he's a mensch, very elegant. Look at that.
And
fantastic.
And we were good friends, been good friends for over 50 years, Dori and I, mm-hmm, and we still talk to each other. So I talked to her about Rothko. I talked to other people about Rothko, including Alfred Barr, who was the director of...
Did Alfred Barr agree right away to do a Rothko show? Because, you know, because Jackson Pollock had a show after his death at MoMA.
That's right. And then the next American show was Mark Rothko.
Yes.
Because that's what I wanted to do. And my colleagues there, Alfred Barr, thought it was a good idea. And my boss, Rene Dunning-Coeur, was very happy that I was going to do it. And there was no real problem, except, as you mentioned, with Philip Johnson.
Yes, so explain to us.
Well, at that point, Mark was working on a chapel at that point designed by Philip Johnson, and we talked about that. And he liked the idea very, very much of working in the chapel. He did not like the idea that he was going to be, in a way, partners with Philip Johnson, who had been a big Nazi. Which had been, I mean,
not a bit, more than a bit.
A big Nazi.
Yeah, a big Nazi. Yeah, yeah. I thought you said a bit Nazi, a big Nazi. Yes.
A big, big Nazi.
Yes,
I think he was even part of the invasion of Poland. So, I mean, he was really...
Stark Nazi, with
a major Nazi. Also a very arrogant man. But also he was very rich, so he could always give things to the Museum of Modern Art. Whenever he felt like it, because he had big, big, big family money. But anyhow, so... but I decided to do the show, and did something which most people had not done at that point. When Museum of Art would do a show, the curator would be the one to do the show, and the artist was hardly consulted. And I realized it was much better to consult with him. And his idea that I worked with him on the paintings that were selected. He talked to me. He wanted an exhibition that would look like a room that he had in the Phillips collection in Washington, where four beautiful Mark Rothkos were hanging by themselves. He wanted to show the painting to be hung as low as possible, to have a confrontation between the viewer and the painting. I mean, he wanted to hang them so low we couldn't do it because the cleaning ladies were there. And he wanted a specific kind of light, and he wanted partitions. So you were really confronted with only two or three paintings at a time before you walked in the next area.
So when you were hanging the show with Rothko, a lot of people said he was difficult.
He was difficult?
Difficult. Tell us the truth. That's the time to tell us the truth. No, was he really grumpy and difficult?
I'm sure he was difficult to many people. But I was smart enough to let him make some of the major decisions.
Give us examples.
But the way they would be hung, the way they would be lit, and as I say, even the selection of the work.
Yes.
You know, a lot of them came from Milan, from Campanza, so they had to be brought all the way, brought from Italy. There were many Rothkos around New York, but the Panza had bought some of the best paintings, so we had to bring them from Italy and so on.
One thing I want also to ask you, the show took place in 1961, and he decided to refuse the commission for Philip Johnson, the Seagram Building, in 1959.
Yeah.
So you were the first one to show those panels, right?
Yes, yes, yeah. Yeah, these panels had not been shown in the gallery. He was with Sidney Chanis at that point. They had not been seen. They had really not been seen.
Yes, they had not been seen.
They had not been seen. And now they're at the Tate. And they're wonderful, very well installed there. They had not been seen, and they were, people were very surprised because they had only seen the rectangle, the floating rectangles, but these were totally different. You showed totally different. They really involved the viewer, but immediately in their rectangular shape.
One thing I think is very interesting is that from this time, from the commission of the Seagram Building, he begins to think site specifically.
Yes,
and I think that. What is very interesting as well is when you told us that you discovered his work when you saw it at the Museum of Chicago in reality. You said, I had seen reproductions.
Yeah.
I think that Rothko's art has to be seen live.
Absolutely.
Now, don't you agree with that?
I totally agree. But I would say that most art has to be seen alive rather than a reproduction.
No, but would say more his.
But Rothko especially. Yeah, Rothko especially.
Why? Why? I have an answer. Tell me.
Well,
tell me. I want to check.
The thin texture of his pigment You know, it's a very, very thin texture. The total opposite, let's say, from what de Kooning was doing at the same time. I mean, de Kooning, you love the thick texture of the vibrant. And Rothko is very quiet and thin. So you see the texture, you see the ones with the floating rectangles, the fuzzy areas between the two rectangles, which are so, so essential, the floating things. So, you know, they cannot really be reproduced. And they have to be a certain size. There are a number of Rothkos have been floating around. They were painted by him on a small size. Mm-hmm. And they don't really work. They are nice to look at. But the size is extremely important for this confrontation. And the one thing I want to say, he was people like Clement Greenberg. He was called what's the word I'm trying to say? I'm sorry. I'll come back in.
You're talking about the way Greenberg would describe him, or
The way he would describe him as this was not. The work was so intimate. And he didn't see them. Yeah, but it's color field painting.
Yes, color field painting.
And that's how Greenberg called him. That in many of the literature, it's called a color field painter. But in studio, if somebody called him a color field painter, Rothko would show them the door. He said, these are not color fields. They are paintings about human emotion. And that you don't see in any reproduction. This is what separates him so totally from color field painters, let's say like Kenneth Nolan, Nolan's paintings are color fields, but basically they're boring paintings. because it's the opposite, because Rothko really dealt with joy and tragedy. Their painting, that's what they're about. And that's why they're so magnificent. You go to the Rothko Chapel, you know, it changes your life practically to see these paintings. And I don't think anybody's life would be changed by seeing a color field painter. I think this is important.
One thing I discovered when I did research at the Menil Foundation is a testimony by Motherwell.
Yeah.
Who said, when I went to Mark's studio, everything was hidden. And he said, we did not know exactly what he did with his pigments.
Yeah.
And it apparently, at the end of his life, he started to discover chemical elements which helped him pull the viewer into the painting, like chemically, by mixing up. You know, egg tempera with acrylic painting.
Yeah.
So there was a kind of real scientific discovery that he did in order to create the effect he needed.
Exactly.
Do you agree with that?
I totally agree.
We agree with on everything.
He would never allow anybody to see him make his painting. Mm-hmm. I mean, there was a very intimate thing making these paintings. With all the time I spend in the studio, I would never see him paint.
There was a secrecy about it.
Yeah, it was secret. That's a personal thing between him and the canvas.
I want to ask you, Peter, may I call you Peter?
Yes, indeed.
Okay. So when, you know, I think it's absolutely fascinating that very few painters have managed, as he did, to impose their views as today.
Yeah.
Today, in 2015, you have a Rothko room at the Phillips Collection in Washington, which is perfectly what he wanted. You sit in a worn-out bench, and you just talk to the paintings. There's no label, nothing.
Yeah.
There is a Rothko room at the Tate Gallery in London. There is a Rothko Museum in Daugavpils. There is the Rothko Chapel in Houston, there is a Rothko collection at the National Gallery. So even if he committed suicide, even if he went into this tension between art as consumption and art as a spiritual matter, he managed to reach over to the 21st century.
And the 22nd.
Don't you agree with that?
Absolutely. You know, I mean, he's going to be people, as far as we can tell, would admire his work forever. Because, especially people who see the originals and spend some time with them. You know, you can't just look at them.
And what you said before is that when you sit in the Rothko chapel, when you sit in the Rothko room, it is something which empowers you.
Yes.
The emotional, the spiritual, the intellectual dialogue that the art... Look, the Rothko chapel has become a place of pilgrimage.
Yes.
For non-violent leaders, political leaders from all over the world. In front of it is a broken obelisk by Barnett Newman, dedicated to Martin Luther King, you know?
Yeah.
And
then there's the chapel of Twombly right next to it.
Yes, it's next to it,
which is pretty wonderful, too.
It's really wonderful. Yeah. And what he has done, Mark Rothko, by refusing to comply with, you know, traditional institution, he has managed to create a new kind of institution together with another immigrant, Dominique Dumenil. Yeah. And this new kind of institution is changing the life. So this kid, who was an immigrant, became an artist, then a pioneer, and a transforming agent of American society. Don't you agree with me?
We do agree.
And we have not planned it, I promise. We never rehearsed. We never rehearsed. So what else would you like to add, Peter?
I don't know. What can I say except if you can get to Houston? Not that Houston is a nice place, but he can put up with the Texans, and if you can go to Houston, and give yourself time and spend time in the chapel, and sort of complete the dialogue between what Rothko has done and your response, I think it would be a great experience.
You know, would you agree that today, with the violence, with the, you know, with the terrorism, with the confrontations, with the fights, the Rothko Chapel is an ecumenical place?
Yes.
And this is it's something ethical as well, political as well.
Yeah.
If I were to ask you, what is Jewish art? Is Rothko Jewish? You told me yesterday, may I say to the audience?
Yeah.
You told me, I hardly knew I was Jewish in Germany, right?
Yeah, that's
you were a completely secular Jew.
Yeah.
And you got out of Germany because of the Kristallnacht, oder?
Yeah.
Kristallnacht.
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I don't think that Rothko never really talked about being a Jewish painter. Mm-hmm. And I mean, he was very much of a Jewish painter. There's no question about it. But he talked about a Greek tragedy. Mm-hmm. He talked about reading Shakespeare.
About Nietzsche.
About Nietzsche. The only Jewish literature I know that I talked to him about was Buber.
Oh, yeah? Martin Buber. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Martin Buber. He read I and Thou, Ich und Du by Buber. But aside from that, you and I think, feel that there's something, that there are Jewish paintings. But I'm not sure what that means.
But you know, do you remember Harold Rosenberg wrote this text called Is There a Jewish Art in 1946? Yeah. And his conclusion was, there are immigrant painters. You know, Gorky, de Kooning, Rothko. And what an immigrant brings with him is a search for identity.
Yeah. And that maybe that's why, as an immigrant, responded so much to the same artists.
Don't you think that the immigrant painters brought something to American art?
Oh, absolutely.
Which was essential?
Absolutely. Yes.
You are an immigrant yourself.
Yeah.
And this and maybe, constant
yeah,
search.
I don't know whether being an immigrant myself it put me more in tune with the immigrant Mark Rothko, but you know, that's hard to know. But this, it's a fact that this is true. Mm-hmm. And the Kooning.
Are you happy to be here tonight?
Oh, yes, indeed. I'm very pleased to be here. And there's all this wonderful audience. So, thank you very much. And thank you very much.
I think we have questions for from the audience. Stephanie, you want to get the microphone?
Okay. The first question is going to be over here on this side.
Yes.
I read something recently about Rothko's murals that were in fact installed in the dining room in the Seagram's building, and they had lost a great deal of the color because of the sun damage and are being restored through projecting light. Could you comment on that?
They were never installed. Rothko refused to install them there.
Peter, no. She's talking about the ones from Harvard.
Oh, the Harvard.
I think
not
the murals from the Seagram.
From
Harvard.
Yeah, the Harvard ones, I have not seen them restored. But he experimented with these paintings and with the pigment of these paintings, and the experiment was not a good one. And then they were installed with too much sunlight on them in that room. And they deteriorated fairly quickly. And as I understand now, they have been pretty well restored.
Yes, they have been. The restoration came from lasers, from light.
I see.
From MIT. So I don't know if you've seen the way they have been restored.
No, I've not.
Some people have told me they don't think it works. So instead of, you know, changing the color on the canvas.
Yeah.
They project light, you see what I mean?
I see.
You know, this is what it is. So yeah. I have not seen, I'll be in Boston next week. So I promise I'll send you a message. Okay, promise, give me your address. Okay.
The next question is up here.
Did Rothko ever visit the chapel in Houston before he died? And what did he think?
No, he died before the chapel was finished. He died before the chapel was finished.
He died in February. He committed suicide the 25th of February, 1970.
But
and the chapel was inaugurated exactly a year later.
But one thing I should mention, because the dimension of the chapel, the architects of the chapel, is almost identical to his studio on East 69th Street. So what they finally did, when they got rid of Philip Johnson, what they finally did, they made a building, the Demeniels created this building, which was almost identical to his studio.
Yes, yes. No, so he did, you know, in fact, he did not see it, and maybe he didn't plan it for this political gathering that it has become.
Yeah.
But nevertheless, it has become
something,
you know, ethical.
Yeah.
A political pilgrimage, right?
Yeah.
But maybe it was not planned in his head.
No, I don't think so.
Okay.
It was planned as a place of reflection.
For, meditation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Question up here on the right.
I understand Mr. Rothko was quite ill towards the end of his life, and that's probably reflected in some of his use of dark colors. Was that the main reason, in your opinion, he committed suicide? Was he in great pain? I think he had rheumatoid arthritis, or just couldn't even get up and paint towards the end of his life.
Yeah, he had the arthritis. That's very true. His eyesight was very, very bad. He couldn't really see very well anymore. So there were all kinds of reasons. And he had split from his wife and had left a beautiful house on the, up on the Upper East Side, very very elegant house, and lived in a studio on a, and slept on a cot like a young artist. So there were many, many reasons coming together. But
did you see him a lot during the last month of his life, Peter?
Well, I saw him. I was in California, so but the last time I saw him, I looked at all these black and gray paintings, and I thought they were paintings about death, and he was pretty depressed. And when I said how much I liked these paintings, he said he didn't believe me, and that Tom Messer had been there the day before and also told him how much he liked them. He said, "We're just trying to make him feel good." And so after I left the studio, I ran into Michael Goldberg, the second generation, sort of a de Kooning second generation abstract expressionist. And Goldberg at that point had, his studio was in the same Bowery's place in the Bowery, where Rothko's studio was. And so I talked to Michael for a while, and I told him that Mark was very depressed. So he asked me, what can we do about that? And I said, well, I think if you would have a party, invite some young artists, because Rothko doesn't believe the young artists still liked him, invite some young artists and have a studio party in his old studio. I think that would help. And Michael Goldberg said, yes, it's a good idea, but it never happened because the time went by.
I think that the last years of his life, I mean, actually the last month of his life, as you said, he had left his wife, he was living in his studio.
Yeah.
He could not really paint very much because he had to take drugs for his illness. He was also an alcoholic, he was drinking a lot.
Bernard Rice, who was his advisor, who also worked for the Marlborough Gallery, kept telling him, don't paint too much. He said, your prices will go down if there are too many paintings. Oof. So he said, don't make too many paintings because it's not a good marketing situation. Yeah.
Oh my God. And you know, I think he was not producing much, but he was also dealing with the paintings he had in storages, right?
Yes, yes.
And a lot of people were coming to ask him to show the storages and to do shows, and he was not very good at that, right?
That's right.
And do you have any explanation for why he disappeared like that? Do you know? Were you surprised when you heard?
Did he come in?
Yes.
I was surprised, yes. I know, I didn't think. I knew he was depressed, but I think everybody was. Didn't expect that. But it was part of the drama he had to enact.
The drama?
Yeah, the drama in his paintings.
Yes.
The drama in his life.
Yes, 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 yes.
Next question is all the way up here.
Hi, this question is for Annie. Could you talk a little bit about Rothko's complex relationship with the Talmud and how he carried his Jewish values into his art?
Yes, yes. Yes. The first real question is why was he put to a Talmud Torah? Then, Peter, you interrupt me.
Yeah, go ahead.
Because you might have to, okay. So my inquiry, my research, my question to the family, and so on, brought me to understand. Because the question is, why does a father, who is secular, who is a Bundist, would put only his younger son to a Talmud Torah when the three older children were to non-religious schools? It seems to me, from what I understood, that there were two older boys and an older daughter who were 14 years older than him. The Jewish children at the time were threatened by to be forced to go to the Russian army. And they would then remain 25 years, you know, drafted.
Yeah.
And the only way to protect them was to put them in a religious school. So it might be the only reason why the father put the younger son into a Talmud Torah to protect him against being drafted.
But what about the older son?
They were threatened to be drafted, and the father took them to the United States.
Oh, yeah.
So he left in 1911 with the two older sons to the U.S., and Marcus remained with the mother and the sister behind, you see? So that first thing shows that he is alone in his family to be educated in the Talmud.
Yeah.
So it's already something a little odd. Then when he arrives in the US with his mother and his sister joining the father and the brothers in Portland, Oregon, the father, who used to be the prestigious pharmacist of Vinsk, has become the owner of a drugstore in Little Odessa in Portland, which is basically a downfall. Yeah. And then the father gets sick and dies 6 months after the young Marcus arrives. Oh. Now, what happens? He alone at the age of 10 has to go and say the Kaddish for his father for a whole year. Nobody else in the family does it.
No.
So what he said later is that after that, I never went to a synagogue anymore. You can tell us if you ever saw him go to a synagogue. But no. I think that in a way.
But on the other hand, it's interesting. He didn't go to a synagogue, did he? But when he, the group called the Ten, they were all Jews.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
There was not a goy among them.
What I would say is that Rothko carries Jewish values.
Yeah.
Rothko is an educator, he's an intellectual,
he's a
leader, he's a fighter, and he carries ethical values, he carries ecumenical values, he's inclusive, and he does not comply. So this is the way he will carry over the legacy of the Talmud.
Yeah.
Did I answer your question?
I think we're going to wrap it up for the evening, but I wanted to remind everybody that Annie is going to be signing Mark Rothko in the atrium, and we'll have some cookies and some coffee.
Uh-huh.
And I want to give a big hand, round of applause to our guests. Thank you, Peter Selz.
Rapidly, if we do not educate them, they will overrun us. A few years ago, every single scholarship of any value was won by a Jew. We must put a ban on the Jews. Frederick S. Jones, Dean of Yale College, 1921. So no wonder that the young Marcus Rodkovich, who thinks he's getting into the epitome of, you know, the elite universities, finds himself with, you know, students who are more interested in sports and, you know, fraternities than in scholar matters. So what he does, he creates his own magazine, the Yale Saturday Evening Pest, that is going to disappear when he disappears after a year and a half. And this is what he attacks. He attacks the false gods of these students, which are, you know, clubs of sports clubs and fraternities, false gods, idols of clay. There is only one way to smash them, and that is a revolution in mind and spirit in the student body at Yale University. Let us doubt, let us think, that is enough. So we see a young scholar who is not ready to comply with the institutions who are rejecting him, who is standing up, who is a rebel, who is a writer, who is an intellectual. And after a year and a half, he leaves Yale and, you know, goes and work with his family here and there, travels back and forth to Portland until he finds a revelation in becoming an artist. Becoming an artist for him will be both an epiphany and a necessity. The first group he joins is the group of the 10. They are actually 9, but they are experimenters by the very nature of their approach and strongly individualistic. Here they are: Ilya Bolotovsky, Adolf Gottlieb, Louis Harris, Yankel Kufeld, Markus Rotkovich, Louis Schenker, Nahum Chabakov, Joseph Solman, Bencion Weinman, all immigrants, first or second generation. So they are linked by a common bond, which is that of migration. They are not linked by their works, which, as you see, are completely different. Some are abstract, some are cubist, some are expressionist. So those young artists are not linked by any aesthetic reasons, except that they fight the galleries in New York City. So it's a social bond. The next step in his career is that Markus Rotkovich becomes an educator, a teacher, at the Brooklyn Jewish Center School Academy, according to John Dewey's theories, and for 25 years he's going to be a teacher there. Teaching art will give him both stability financially and professionally. And we'll see what it means for him to be an educator later on. What else he does, he's writing a book at the age, in 1940, at the time where the Nazi armies are invading Europe. He puts his brush aside and takes a pencil, and for one whole year, he stops painting and he writes. He writes this book, The Artist's Reality, Philosophies of Art. In this book, he revisits art history from antiquity. He asks himself, when were the golden ages for the artist? What is art? What is the function of an artist in society? And that whole book, where he revisits, you know, the great thinkers of Europe, the great old masters of Europe, will help him change his aesthetic patterns, switch to mythological, and then surrealist, and then abstract. Now, two sentences from this book which I want to quote for you. Art is not only a form of action, it is a form of social action. And the history of art is the history of men who, for the most part, have preferred hunger to compliance. So we see that in his mind, there is a kind of romantic image of the painter as a hero who goes his way, even if his way is not the way society is going. So it's a very strong decision, and one of the artists of the past that Rothko is going to completely identify with is Rembrandt, especially the late Rembrandt, that has decided to paint his own way and not to comply with the taste of the time. Then another specific attitude of Mark Rothko is that he will always, throughout his career, be on a search, shuttling, searching, changing. In this case, between the West Coast and the East Coast, as I told you, he spent the first part of his life in the United States, in Portland, Oregon, but he finds San Francisco much more appealing, in fact, than Portland. So shuttling between West Coast and East Coast, between US models and European models. The big influence of his life as a painter is Clifford Steele, who invites him to come to San Francisco, where he will spend many summers teaching, painting, living, and where his art will definitely take a shift towards this more expressive abstraction. And a very important moment also before 1950, where he gets into abstraction, is that at the Museum of Modern Art, he sees this painting by Henri Matisse, The Red Studio, painted in 1911, which Alfred Barr has bought for the permanent collection. So Mark Rothko sees the paintings, which is exhibited in the galleries, and for 3 weeks he's going to sit in front of it, absorbing himself inside the painting, inside the red, the flat red. It is, as you see, a studio of an artist with paintings and sculptures which are unfinished. And in the center, there's a void. In this void, this is the place where the artist should stand and either finish the works or leave them like that. If he finishes them, they become immortal works of art. If he does not, they go to garbage. So this painting, for me, is a metaphor of the power of creation. And I think that it is not an accident that it helped Rothko to get to his definitive signature style. Very quickly, Mark Rothko is going to go on fighting American institutions when he does not accept their attitude. For example, the Met, the Metropolitan Museum. He is very conscious that the Metropolitan Museum of Art has a collection of American art which is not what it should be, because at the time they rejected, you know, the collection of Gertrude Vanderbilt Whitney. They rejected, they preferred European art. So with a group of friends, the Irascibles, they are very angry. Here we have Mark Rothko, Barnett Newman, Jackson Pollock, and Bill de Kooning. They write a letter to the New York Times, public letter, a letter which is going to be published in the New York Times to the director of the museum, where they say, we draw to the attention of these gentlemen the historical fact that for roughly 100 years, only advanced art has made any consequential contribution to civilization. That was to attack an exhibition where only regional artists were showed, and not this group, not the more progressive artists. So anytime an institution is not behaving the way Rothko plans it, accepts it, he stands up and writes. Nevertheless, at the Modern, Dorothy Miller will show him in a group called 15 Americans, 1952. His gallerist will be Peggy Guggenheim, then Betty Parsons, then Sidney Janis. And in the 50s, he becomes a very successful artist, rich, successful, very well regarded by the critics. A very important show will take place at the Chicago Art Institute, put together by Catherine Koo in 1954. And it's after 1959 that we have the third part of his trajectory. He becomes a pioneer. Why would you ask then? Would you ask why, if he is a successful artist, does he decide to shift gears? And that's exactly what he's going to do. In 1958, he's commissioned a piece for the Seagram Building, which he will not do. And that will start this period. During those years, he experimented ceaselessly, each painting a new adventure. He left little to chance, studying how the intensity, texture, and overall area of certain colors interacted. So instead of remaining the successful painter with his signature style, Mark Rothko is going to become a pioneer. How come? Because the Bronfman family is building on Park Avenue this huge skyscraper, the Seagram Building, commissioned by Philip Johnson. And for their restaurant, the Four Seasons restaurant, they want the best panels surrounding the public, and they ask Mark Rothko to deal with them. Mark Rothko will work on these panels for 1 year.
They had not been seen. They had really not been seen.
Yes, they had not been seen.
They had not been seen. And now, of course, now they're at the Tate. And they're wonderful, they're very well installed there. They had not been seen, and they were, people were very surprised because they had only seen the rectangle, the floating rectangles. But these were totally different. You saw totally different. They really involved the viewer, but immediately in their rectangular shape.
One thing I think is very interesting is that from this time, from the commission of the Seagram Building, yeah, he begins to think site specifically.
Yes.
And I think that what is very interesting as well is when you told us that you discovered his work when you saw it at the Museum of Chicago,
yeah,
in reality. You said, I had seen reproductions.
Yeah.
I think that Rothko's art has to be seen live.
Absolutely.
Now, don't you agree with that?
I totally agree. But I would say that most art has to be seen alive rather than a reproduction.
No, but I would say more his.
But Rothko especially. Yeah, Rothko especially.
Why? Why? I have an answer. Tell me.
Well,
tell me. I want to check.
The thin texture of his pigment, you know, it's a very, very thin texture. The total opposite, let's say, from what de Kooning was doing at the same time. I mean, de Kooning, you love the thick texture of the vibrant, and Rothko is very quiet and thin. So you see the texture, you see the ones with the floating rectangles, the fuzzy areas between the two rectangles. Which is just so, so essential, the floating things. So, you know, they cannot really, really be reproduced. And they have to be a certain size. There are a number of Rothkos have been floating around that were painted by him on a small, small size. Mm-hmm. And they don't really work. They are nice to look at, but the size is extremely important for this confrontation. And the one thing I want to say, he was people like Clement Greenberg. He was called what's the word I'm thinking? I'm sorry. I'll come back in.
You're talking about the way Greenberg would describe him, or
The way he would describe him as a, this was not. The work was so intimate, and he didn't see them. Yeah, but it's color field painting.
Yes, color field painting.
And that's how Greenberg called him. That in many of the literature, it's called a color field painter. But in studio, if somebody called him a color field painter, Rothko would show them the door. He said, these are not color fields. They are paintings about human emotion. And that you don't see in any reproduction. This is what separates him so totally from color field painters, let's say like Kenneth Nolan, Nolan's paintings are color fields, but basically they're boring paintings. Because it's the opposite. Because Rothko really dealt with joy and tragedy. They're painting, that's what they're about. And that's why they're so magnificent. You go to the Rothko Chapel, you know, it changes your life practically to see these paintings. And I don't think anybody's life would be changed by seeing a color field painting. I think this is important.
One thing I discovered when I did research at the Menil Foundation is a testimony by Motherwell.
Yeah.
Who said, when I went to Mark's studio,
everything
was hidden. And he said, we did not know exactly what he did with his pigments.
Yeah.
And it apparently, at the end of his life, he started to discover chemical elements which helped him pull the viewer into the painting, like chemically, by mixing up, you know, egg tempera with acrylic painting.
Yeah.
So there was a kind of real scientific discovery that he did in order to create the effect he needed.
Exactly.
Do you agree with that?
I totally agree.
We agree with everything.
He would never allow anybody to see him make his painting. Mm-hmm. I mean, there was a very intimate thing making these paintings, but all the time I spent in the studio, I would never see him paint.
There was a secrecy about it.
Yeah, it was secret, but that's a personal thing between him and the canvas.
I want to ask you, Peter, may I call you Peter?
Yes, indeed.
Okay. So when, you know, I think it's absolutely fascinating that very few painters have managed, as he did, to impose their views as today.
Yeah.
Today, in 2015, you have a Rothko room at the Phillips Collection in Washington, which is perfectly what he wanted. You sit in a worn-out bench, and you just talk to the paintings. There's no label, nothing.
Yeah.
There is a Rothko room at the Tate Gallery in London. There is a Rothko Museum in Daugavpils. There is the Rothko Chapel in Houston.
Yeah.
There is the Rothko Collection at the National Gallery. So even if he committed suicide, even if he went into this tension between art as consumption and art as a spiritual matter, he managed to reach over to the 21st century.
And the 22nd.
Don't you agree with that?
Absolutely. You know, I mean, he's going to be a 21st, people, as far as we can tell, would admire his work forever. Because, especially people who see the originals and spend some time with them. You know, you can't just look at them.
And what you said before is that when you sit in the Rothko Chapel, when you sit in the Rothko room, it is something which empowers you.
Yes.
The emotional, the spiritual, the intellectual dialogue that the art. Look, the Rothko Chapel has become a place of pilgrimage.
Yes.
For non-violent leaders, political leaders from all over the world. In front of it is a broken obelisk by Barnett Newman, dedicated to Martin Luther King. You know.
Yeah.
And
then there's the chapel of Twombly right next to it.
Yes, it's next to it,
which is pretty wonderful, too.
It's really wonderful. Yeah. And what he has done, Mark Rothko, by refusing to comply with, you know, traditional institution, he has managed to create a new kind of institution together with another immigrant, Dominique de Menil, and this new kind of institution is changing the life. So this kid, who was an immigrant, became an artist, then a pioneer, and a transforming agent of American society. Don't you agree with me?
I totally do agree.
And we have not planned it, I promise. We never rehearsed. We never rehearsed. So what else would you like to add, Peter? For our
I don't know. What can I say except if you can get to Houston, not that Houston is a nice place, But he can put up with the Texans, and if you can go to Houston, and give yourself time, and spend time in the chapel, and sort of complete the dialogue between what he is, what Rothko has done, and your response, I think it would be a great experience.
You know, would you agree that today, with the violence, with the, you know, with the terrorism, with the confrontations, with the fights, the Rothko Chapel is an ecumenical place?
Yes.
And this is the it's something ethical as well, political as well.
Yeah.
If I were to ask you, what is Jewish art? Is Rothko Jewish? You told me yesterday, may I say to the audience?
Yeah.
You told me, I hardly knew I was Jewish in Germany, right?
Yeah, that's
you were a completely secular
yeah,
Jew.
Yeah.
And you got out of Germany because of the Kristallnacht,
yeah.
Oder?
Yeah.
Kristallnacht.
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit more about that.
But I don't think that Rothko never really talked about being a Jewish painter. Mm-hmm. And I mean, he was very much of a Jewish painter, there's no question about it. But he talked about a Greek tragedy, mm-hmm. he talked about reading Shakespeare.
About Nietzsche.
About Nietzsche. The only Jewish literature I know that I talked to him about was Buber.
Oh, yes, yeah, Martin Buber.
Yeah, Martin Buber. He read I and Thou, Ich und Du by Buber. But aside from that, I think, feel that there's something, that there are Jewish paintings, but I'm not sure what that means.
But you know, do you remember Harold Rosenberg wrote this text called yeah. Is There a Jewish Art in 1946? Yeah. And his conclusion was, there are immigrant painters, you know, Gorky, de Kooning, Rothko. And what an immigrant brings with him
yeah.
is a search for identity.
Yeah. And that that's why as an immigrant responded so much to them. But the same artists.
Don't you think that the immigrant painters brought something to American art?
Oh, absolutely.
Which was essential?
Absolutely. Yes.
You are an immigrant yourself.
Yeah.
And this.
And maybe.
Constant
yeah,
research.
I don't know whether being an immigrant myself it put me more in tune with the immigrant Mark Rothko. But you know.
Before spending his summer in Europe. This summer, he's going to shuttle in his head between Park Avenue and Europe, going to Naples, going to Florence, to see the Convento di San Marco, Fra Angelico, and noticing that this is exactly the way he wants his paintings to be. He wants the viewer to have the feeling that he interacts with his art. And so he starts doubting about what he's doing at in the Seagram building. Then he goes to England, meets his British disciples. He meets William Scott. He meets them all in a little colony in Cornwall, where he sees a ruined chapel, medieval chapel, and feels that it is much more in this medieval chapel that he wants his art to be than on Park Avenue. Definitely he doesn't belong to that crowd. So he comes back, and that's when he gives back the money, he takes back the panels, and a few years later, Peter Selz decides to give him a solo show at MoMA in 1961, which is going to be an absolutely beautiful show, where the panels for the Seagram building will be exhibited. And this might be the climax of his career. This is what Peter Selz wrote about. This is what Catherine Koo. As I look back, it was Mark's Museum of Modern Art exhibition in 1961 that radically changed his point of view. This is a landmark exhibition. And Peter Selz, in the catalog, described these silent paintings as dealing directly with human emotions, desires, relationships, for they are mirrors of our fantasies and serve as echoes of our experience. Now, after this show, Mark Rothko is working on his last project with this woman, his new patron, Dominique Dominil, who comes to him after hearing that he decided not to finish the Seagram building because he doesn't want to comply with that kind of crowd. He doesn't want to paint for people who would eat in front of his paintings. He wants people to weep in front of his paintings, not to eat in front of his paintings. So Dominique Dominil, who is also an immigrant, who came from France in 1941, lived in Houston, and has always fought for the African Americans, for example, decides that she will build a chapel and Rothko would be doing the panels. They're working together until the Rothko Chapel in Houston is being inaugurated exactly a year after he commits suicide. And this is the inside of the chapel. I don't know if you have been there, but it's one of the most extraordinary places. And it is exactly what Rothko had dreamt to do. He wanted a space to be a space of meditation, a space with spiritual values rather than, consumption values. He wanted art to be an experience. He wanted the viewer to sit and interact with his paintings. He wanted his paintings to be law, to be on an off-white wall. He wanted them to be very little lighted. And he really was very specific about the fact that people shouldn't pass by, but people should stay. People should be surrounded by art. So this is how he decided during the MoMA show of 1961 that he wanted to bring out a revolution in viewing. He wanted to revolutionize the way people would look at art and art be an experience. This is what Peter Selz wrote about these murals. These murals, like medieval altar pieces, really seem to ask for a special place apart, a kind of sanctuary, where they may perform what is essentially a sacramental function. So you see that the evolution in his work has taken a very interesting turn. And I will now go to another angle, that of the geographical trajectories, because Mark Rothko's life is one of displacement and migration. He was born in the Russian Empire in the city called Dvinsk, which is now part of Latvia. They traveled to the United States on a boat, such as the one that Stieglitz is showing here. They traveled by boat, by train, throughout the United States, and it took 3 weeks to go from New Haven to Portland. And he told his friend Motherwell, "You cannot imagine what it is," he said, "to be dressed like a little boy from Dvinsk in black suit, traveling all over the United States with the label around my neck, which said, 'I don't speak English.'" So that was one of the trauma of his life. Then once he was living in New York, he traveled nonstop. He went back to the West Coast, San Francisco, we see a lot. He went back to Portland, so East Coast, West Coast. Then he went back to Europe a lot, looking, searching, shuttling. His favorite country in Europe being Italy, and then England, and then the Netherlands. And then in New York also, he had many houses, many studios, always changing, always searching. Interesting also is to notice his family genealogy. His father, Jakob Rotkowicz, was a pharmacist in Dvinsk, a very secular man, very well-read man. He was also the public writer of the city. He would write letters for people. He was a member of the Bund. And here is Markus Rutkowicz sitting with his little cousin standing, showing him off with a white ball. And I think that it's very interesting to see how the little boy of five, the little kid from the Talmud Torah, is already very serious, you know, very serious, like a real mensch. Think he didn't change his looks, you know. And we see him with the family here sitting to the right, and the cousin has a little dog. You know, the cousin is a worldly guy. And he, Markus Rutkowicz, has a book in his hands, you know. This is the family. And this is him with his wife, Mel, who was very beautiful and very interesting, very well-educated woman that gave him stability. His son, Christopher, who was six when his father committed suicide. But something happened with the son. And, you know, Mark Rothko changed gallery after Sidney Janis in 1962. Because Sidney Janis had accepted to do a show of pop artists, and Rothko hated pop artists. So he left Sidney Janis for another gallery, the Marlborough Gallery, which was not very ethical with him. And there was a lawsuit when he committed suicide that was started by the children. Kate, who was 17, and Christopher was a little boy, a baby. But they won after a 14 years lawsuit. And the children have had a very important impact on their father's work. So much so that Christopher decided to, the book I showed you before, this manuscript, was found. The manuscript was found by Christopher recently. He transcribed the text he saw, he edited it, and he published it 10 years ago at Yale University Press. And this book, The Artist's Reality, gives us the core of Mark Rothko's project. I think it's a very essential book, and I think it's extremely beautiful that a little boy who was six when his father passed away became the one who gave life to his father's voice so many decades later. But there's more to that. This is Kate and Christopher on the 23rd of April 2013. They invited me to go to the opening of the Rothko Center in Daugavpils, the name of the city Dvinsk, where their father was born. Why? Because they had been asked to come back to the place where their father was born for his 100th anniversary. They first went. Their father had never gone back. I don't know if you know about the history of Latvia. Latvia is a country where the Jews were treated in the most despicable way. I don't know if there was a nice way to be, you know, persecuting the Jews and killing them, but this is maybe the worst one, by the Waffen-SS, and the Latvian people joined them. And the thriving Jewish culture was totally destroyed. The people were sent to the Forest of Rumbula, killed, and immediately. It was horrible. So all Jewish culture has disappeared in Latvia. Nevertheless, Christopher and Kate went. The first thing they did was they supported the restoration of one synagogue on the 43 that were destroyed. And a few years later, here, they accepted to lend 8 works of art from their father to open a Mark Rothko Center in the city where he was born, which was a huge building that I attended. I attended the opening. And when I went there, I saw in this gesture something very moving. I saw in this gesture a continuation of the father's decision, project, in his book, that the artist be a prophet, and that the work of art be something that in Hebrew we call it tikkun ha'olam, the reparation of the world. So the children of Mark Rothko, by coming, by going, by lending works of art in this country, decided to perpetuate their father's project. So that's how I would like to end before telling you that one of my friends from Berkeley called Tom Ludi, who sits in the audience, came to Paris a month ago and told me, do you know that Peter Selz is my neighbor, my friend, and lives in Berkeley? So Peter Selz, I made a mistake. I did not check where he was when I did my research, and I felt terrible. I felt, well, Peter Selz did this most wonderful show at MoMA, and I didn't go and interview him. So I wrote to him a note last Sunday, like 2 days ago. I wrote a note to Peter Selz saying, I apologize, I have not interviewed you, but I would love you to be at the Jewish Cultural Center in San Francisco, if you may. And this is what he wrote me back. Dear Annie Cohen Solal, thank you very much for your kind note, which I just received. I will most certainly be at your lecture at the JCC. I think your Rothko book shows a deep understanding of his life and his great work. Mark would have liked to read all of it. Having read your Rothko book, I am now immersed in Leo. So much I did not know. Old as I am still learning. I also want to give you a book to you on Wednesday. If anything is planned after your lecture, I would be most pleased to attend. With best wishes, Peter Selz. Here is Peter Selz. Peter is coming. I was expecting him to the right. Hello, Peter. So, we're going to talk with Peter. Hello, Peter. Welcome.
Hello.
Welcome.
Hello.
Welcome. I think you're having the right thing. Here is Peter. You sit here. Here, wherever you want. I don't mind. This way. Peter was born in Munich in 1919 on the 27th of March. So in a week, in a 2 weeks, he's turning 97. I think this is historical. I was so moved. And he came alone. He came alone from Munich to the United States at the age of 17. His grandfather took him to galleries, to museums. He was born in the art world. After working in a brewery in New York City, he started studying at Columbia, but he was trained by a distant cousin called Alfred Stieglitz, which is not too bad. And then he did his PhD on German Expressionism in 1954 at the University of Chicago. He taught at Pomona College. He became a curator of paintings and sculpture at MoMA when he had his this Mark Rothko show. And then he became professor at Berkeley in the height of the 60s, right?
Yeah,
you were a leftist, a radical.
Yes.
Are you still a radical?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. And two biographies have been written on Peter already, Karl Kastrom, and a memoir by his daughter, Gabrielle Selz. So 5 years ago also, Peter got the College Art Association Award for the best book on art, and he also taught at CUNY. There's so much about him, so much. But what is extraordinary is that this coincidence that, you know, one of the great witnesses of Rothko's life is sitting with us today and can teach us so much more than what I have said. So I want you to talk, but I want just to add something. Oh. Once you said, I have always worked with artists who were not mainstream, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so Mark Rothko, when you ask him, when you want to do the Rothko show in 1961, you did not consider him mainstream then?
No, I think there's a book out of different things I wrote, an anthology published by Cambridge University Press called Beyond the Mainstream. And in general, my work has done very much on the for outsiders. Not Mark Rothko, but when I decided to do the Rothko show at that time,
yes,
he was already very much in the center of attention,
yes,
of New York, of New York artists. So I can't say I discovered him.
Okay. But when did you first meet him? I'd like to know that.
I met him at, around that time. I wanted to meet him because I was going to tell him we were going to do the show. The important, your book talks a good deal about Catherine Koo, who was the curator at the Art Institute of Chicago, where I did my graduate work. And her exhibition was when I really first became involved in Mark Rothko. I was astonished with this work, which I hardly knew before, just in reproduction. And I spent many days looking at these incredible paintings at the Art Institute. And basically, of course, years later, I became curator at the Museum of Modern Art. The first American show I did was of Mark Rothko.
So we are 1954, right?
Yeah.
So in this show in Chicago, Mark Rothko didn't come. He did not come.
No, he did not come.
He did not come. But he had already a very good relationship with her because
yes,
they were writing to each other.
Yes, yes.
And she even wanted to publish the correspondence.
Yes.
She did not do it in the end, but she wanted to do that. Okay, so that's 1954.
54,
now,
yeah.
What happens between 1954 and 1961 in January, on the 18th of January, when you opened the Rothko show?
Well, during those years, I looked at my Rothko paintings whenever I could, and I admired them very, very much. I talked to them when I got to New York. Of course, I realized, you know, I talked to many people who knew his work, had many good conversations about his work with Dorrie Ashton.
Yes, with Dorrie Ashton, of course.
The only good book that's been written about Rothko before yours is hers.
Yes, he's a mensch, very elegant. Yeah. Look at that.
And
fantastic.
And we were good friends, been good friends for over 50 years, Dory and I, mm-hmm, and we still talk to each other. And so I talked to her about Rothko. I talked to other people about Rothko, including Alfred Barr, who was the director of.
Did Alfred Barr agree right away to do a Rothko show? Because, you know, because Jackson Pollock had a show after his death at MoMA.
That's right. And then the next American show was Mark Rothko.
Yes.
Because that's what I wanted to do. And my colleagues there, Alfred Barr, thought it was a good idea. And my boss, Rene Donincourt, was very happy that I was going to do it. And there was no real problem, except, as you mentioned, with Philip Johnson.
Yes, so explain to us.
Well, at that point, Mark was working on a chapel, at that point designed by Philip Johnson, and we talked about that. And he liked the idea very, very much of working on the chapel. He did not like the idea that he was going to be, in a way, partners with Philip Johnson, who had been a big Nazi. A big Nazi.
Yeah, a big Nazi. Yeah, I thought you said a bit Nazi. A big Nazi. Yes.
A big, big Nazi.
Yes,
I think he was even part of the invasion of Poland. So, I mean, he was
Stark
really...
Nazi, vis-à-vis
A major Nazi. Also a very arrogant man. But also he was very rich, so he could always give things to the Museum of Modern Art whenever he felt like it, because he had big, big, big family money. But anyhow, so, But I decided to do the show and did something which most people had not done at that point. When Michel Manard would do a show, the curator would be the one to do the show, and the artist was hardly consulted. And I realized it was much better to consult with him. And his idea that I worked with him on the paintings that were selected. He talked to me. He wanted an exhibition that would look like a room that he had in the Phillips collection in Washington, where four beautiful Mark Rothkos were hanging by themselves. He wanted to show the painting to be hung as low as possible, so to have a confrontation between the viewer and the painting. I mean, he wanted to hang them so low we couldn't do it because the cleaning ladies were and he wanted a specific kind of light, and he wanted partitions. So you were really confronted with only two or three paintings at a time before you walked in the next area.
So when you were hanging the show with Rothko, a lot of people said he was difficult.
He was difficult?
Difficult. Tell us the truth. Well, that's the time to tell us the truth. No, was he really grumpy and difficult?
I'm sure he was difficult to many people. But I was smart enough to let him make some of the major decisions.
Give us examples.
But the way they would be hung, the way they would be lit, as I say, even the selection of the work.
Yes.
You know, a lot of them came from Milan, from Constanza, so they had to be brought all the way, brought from Italy. There were many Rothkos around New York, but the Panza had bought some of the best paintings, so we had to bring them from Italy and so on.
One thing I want also to ask you, the show took place in 1961.
Yeah.
And he decided to refuse the commission for Philip Johnson, the Seagram building, in 1959.
Yeah.
So you were the first one to show those panels, right?
Yes, yes, yeah. Yeah, these panels had not been shown in the gallery. He was with Sidney Chanis at that point.
After her acclaimed biography, Sartre, A Life, 1987, became an international bestseller, translated into 16 languages, cultural historian Annie Cohen Solal was asked by the French president François Mitterrand to serve as the cultural counselor to the French embassy in the United States. Within 2 weeks of her arrival in 1989, she met Leo Castelli, America's most influential art gallerist of the period, who told her, "I'm going to teach you all you need to know about American art." Her encounter with Castelli led her first work of art history, Painting American, 2001, an account of the shift of the artistic center from Paris to New York throughout the late 19th and early 20th centuries. It was awarded the Prix Bernier of the Académie des Beaux-Arts. Her next book, Leo Castelli and His Circle, 2010, was acclaimed by critics as probing, gripping, impeccably judicious, marvelous, impressive, elegant, and was awarded the Art Curial Prize for the best contemporary art book and translated into 5 languages. In 2014, she authored with Paul Goldberger and Robert Gottlieb, New York Mid-Century, which was described as, quote, the work of three masters of their genres, and was hailed as a sparkling account of Gotham and a sophisticated and elegant exploration. As a professor, she has held positions at Tisch School of the Arts at NYU, École des Hautes Études en Sciences Sociales, the École Normale Supérieure in Paris, the Freie University of Berlin, and the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. In 2013 to 14, she became special advisor at the École Normale Supérieure and at the Centre Pompidou, where she worked as chief curator, Magicians of the Earth, 2014. She is now co-leader of a forthcoming workshop at the Center for Advanced Studies in Behavioral Science at Stanford University on the theme Crossing Boundaries. Annie is working on an important exhibition about Rothko and Rembrandt that will debut at the Rijksmuseum in Amsterdam in 2017. Born in Algeria, a Mizrahi Jewish scholar, Cohen Solal received a PhD in history and literature from the Sorbonne and currently lives in Paris. Please welcome Annie Cohen Solal.
Thank you, Laurie. Thank you, Stephanie. I'm going to try to be at the level of these beautiful words. I am indeed delighted to be in San Francisco because, first of all, it's a city which has the same trees as my home country. And the first, as soon as I arrive, I feel home. And I'll be there a lot because of this new position at Stanford. I'm back already in a month, so you'll see a lot of me if you need me. Now, I also want to tell you that in this book tour, the lecture today might be one of the climax of my book tour. I'm talking in a few cities, like more than 10. But San Francisco is a place which had a very specific meaning for Mark Rothko. He wrote a beautiful text one day. He said, "What was there last summer, which seems now to have been so magical in San Francisco?" So there was a magic attached to the city for him. It's a city where he taught and thrived. It's a city where he was happy. It's a city where he experienced things which were not as painful as New York City. And it's also a city where there will be, you'll see later on, a private guest, a surprise guest, which is marvelous. So please wait a little bit. But you'll see this guest. It's extraordinary what happened here 2 days ago. So you'll see. So instead of talking 45 minutes, I'll speak a little less, and then I'll leave space for our guest, a discussion with him. So the first thing I want to tell you about my work, about Mark Rothko in general, is that I am not an art historian. Classical art historian. First of all, by training, I am a historian, a social historian and a cultural historian. So I am not going to spend much time describing works of arts to you, but I'm going more to describe the artist in the context of his time. This is Mark Rothko with the different names he had. He was born Markus Rotkovich. When he came to the US at age 10, they changed his name to Markus Rotkovich with a K and a W and a Z, which he didn't like very much. He thought it was very heavy. And when he changed his name and Americanized it and became an American citizen, he called himself Mark Rothko. Different from his brothers, who called themselves Roth. And that's kind of interesting. This is what he wrote about the city. "The city is unspeakably beautiful and the weather perfect. There is no doubt that by its visual attributes alone, the city has earned the right to be the art center of the world and that we must do something to bring this about." That he wrote from San Francisco in the fall of 1947. So it's first of all a tribute to the city by him. Okay, so my approach is tonight I'm going to to describe Mark Rothko's trajectory through different angles. The first would be the aesthetic way, the aesthetic trajectory. One could talk about him just by saying that first he was painting figurative, 1936, a self-portrait, 1938, entrance to the subway. And then he went to a very quick change of aesthetics between mythological, then surrealist, then multiform, then multiform, and then abstract. Okay, so between 1940 and 1950, he gets to abstraction. And here we have these floating rectangles of color floating on top of the other one. This is his signature style that we see blue in red and yellow, in red and brown, in yellow, and here at the last years of his life, gray, brown, and gray and black. Now, one thing I want to say about the colors. At the Tate Gallery, where there is a Rothko room, a text on the wall says, at the end of his life, Rothko went into a darkening of the palette. So he seems to be explained, all his trajectory seems to be explained by a question of colors. It is something that I will argue against because I think that Rothko's life is much more complicated than a simple question of color and palette. I will argue that his life is that of a painter, but also of an intellectual, of an immigrant, of an artist, of a pioneer. So this is the second angle that I'm going to adopt. The historical angle. First of all, the immigrant. He gets to the US at the age of 10 in 1913. He arrives in Portland, Oregon, by way of a trip throughout the United States, joining his family, the Weinsteins. And as soon as he arrives in Portland, Oregon, he is a very well-read young scholar because he had studied in the Talmud Torah in Vinsk, where he was born. But he notices that in the city, and especially in the high school where he is, the clubs, the debating clubs, are not very welcoming for Jews. So he goes to this neighborhood house, which is a community center organized by the German Jews for the new immigrants, the Russian Jews, and there he becomes a leader. He becomes the chief editor and he writes the editorial for the 10th anniversary. Markus Rodkowicz, A Year's Perspective, he is the one who writes that. So when he faces hostility, when he faces rejection, his attitude is to stand up as a leader and to fight with his pencil and with his words as a writer. Very soon, with his friends Max Neimark and Harry Director, he is brilliant enough to arrive, to manage to get into Yale. Here is what the magazine, the daily paper says. Three Russian boys, none of whom has been in this country longer than 7 years, they are just gone to enter Yale. Well, this is a great achievement for a young scholar. But unfortunately, Yale University in 1921 is a place where Jews are not welcome, and where here, this is him. I don't look like this, he wrote. He doesn't like the way he looks. You know, he looks very stiff, very, very stern. This year, the dean is going to write to the president, the Jews are coming to us by thousands. They win all the scholarships. I think that we have to change our view in regard to the Jewish element. We should do something to improve them. They are getting the